Hi everyone and welcome to another video. In this video, I'll be covering the HP ML330 G6. At first sight, other than the fact that the machine is quite a bit longer in comparison to a regular PC tower, it doesn't look too different. Nevertheless, it's not targeted at home users and that will be pretty clear further on in the video. During this video, I'll do a full teardown of the device and I will rebuild it while performing some upgrades. I'll be replacing the disks with these 4 500 GB drives, upgrade the RAM, and while I'm on it, replace the CPU with a faster model. The machine I have here has the following specifications. Despite doing my best to clean it as good as possible, it still looks a bit like it had better days. Let's have a quick look at the outside first. Also, if you like this kind of videos, don't hesitate to subscribe to my channel. At the front, we can find space for 3 5.25-inch drives, 2 USB ports, LEDs for power, the network interfaces and disk activity, and the power button. We can also find a lock here, which can prevent you from opening up the case. On the back, we have the power supply, which is not redundant, the video card, an NVIDIA Quadro 600, and a card with additional serial ports. Further, we have the VGA connector for the integrated ATI ES1000, another serial port, more USB ports, and gigabit Ethernet. The bottom port of these two can be used for out-of-band integrated lights-out management. Final ports here are 2 PS2 ports. Now that we are familiar with the outside, let's have a look inside. We shouldn't forget to unlock the case, and then we can simply remove the side panel. Inside, the first we notice is the large plastic cover that is optimizing the airflow. After removing it, we can see the rest of the system. We have the Quadro 600, the added serial port card, the CPU, and 9 DDR3 slots. There is also an option to add a mezzanine card that adds a second CPU and 9 memory slots. I guess this kind of explains why that case is so long. Storage is located behind the front of the case. Here one cage is installed, but optionally another one can be added below that one. The disks are easy to remove using those trays or brackets. I guess that by removing those disks, we started the disassembly part. The last two slots contain empty spaces. Let's continue by removing the intake fans. After we remove them, we can see the back of the disk cage, which provides the connections. One single data cable connects here and ends up in 4 separate SATA connectors and an additional cable connected to the motherboard. Let me remove that one. But to get access to the SATA ports, I need to remove the PCIe cards first. I'll start with the video card. Then the card with the additional serial port. Now we can remove all SATA cables. And disconnect the cable from the storage backplane. Next up is the connector for the front LEDs and power button. Then the P4 connector and front USB ports. Last one in this area is an I2C connector towards that SATA backplane as well. This other small connector we have here is for a temperature sensor. On the bottom of the motherboard we have the ATX power connector. And all that remains is to disconnect the back panel. Now that everything is disconnected, we can remove the motherboard from the case. While that's done, let's also remove that SATA backplane so we can have a good look at it. I will start by disconnecting the I2C cable. And two Molex power connectors. Then we can unscrew it. And slide it up to remove it. On the board, we can see the data connector, power connectors, and of course the SATA interfaces. Top left, we can also find that connector for the I2C cable. Last thing that I will remove from the case is the DVD drive. To do so, we can release it by lifting this plastic clip and simply slide it out. We're almost done with the disassembly, but we still need to remove the memory from the board and the CPU. Memory is just releasing the DIMMs from the slots. For the CPU, we first need to remove the heatsink. And under there, we find the CPU covered in old thermal paste. So let's clean that up first. Then we can remove the CPU by lifting the lever and to take it out. As mentioned in the beginning, my machine had a Xeon E5606. As I plan to replace the two existing disks with four new ones, I'm missing two brackets. As you can see, the brackets that have a disk are different from the empty ones. For the two brackets that have a disk already, I can simply remove them by removing the Torx screws on the side. The additional two require some modification, as they're just intended to fill up the space and not to host a disk. My plan is to remove the plastic construction on one side completely and to fix the disk onto that. To do so, I'll just use a small hacksaw and make a hole at the right place. Honestly, the result doesn't look too trustable, but as long as the disks stay in the disk cage, all should be fine. I just wouldn't really recommend to do this for hot swapping disks. Everything is on the table now. The four disks in their tray, old CPU, new CPU, the heatsink to cool it all, memory, serial PCIe card, video card, SATA backplane, DVD drive, and the motherboard itself. Let's have a closer look at that one. Let's start with the 9 memory slots, which has 3 channels with 3 slots for each. The first slot of each channel is colored white. Below those is the ATX power connector and P4 connector. The board also has an internal USB port and SD card reader. Here is the CPU socket and 4 SATA ports connected to the B1110i controller plus 2 additional ones. Next to that, we can find the PCIe slots. Time for the reassembly. I'll start with the CPU. And I will upgrade the E5606 with an X5650. All we need to do is to position it correctly and to close the lever that holds it in place. Before we install the heatsink, we need to apply some fresh thermal paste and then fix the heatsink back to the motherboard. For the memory, I will upgrade the 3x2GB to a single module of 16GB. After these two steps, the motherboard can be reinstalled in the case. Once it's fixed, I'm connecting the ATX power connector and P4 connector. Followed by the fan, which is in the back of the case. After connecting the SATA cable for the DVD drive, it's time for the front USB ports and nearby I2C cable that will end up in the storage backplane. Final cable around here is for the front LEDs and power button. Next up is the data cable for the storage. First, that gray flat cable, followed by the 4 SATA or SAS connectors. The DVD drive can just be slid in and it clicks in place. Then we need to connect it to SATA data and power. Time to put back the drive backplane. Once it's fixed, we can reinsert the power connectors. Followed by the I2C cable and the connector for the SATA port. Almost done here, so we can put back the video card. And that PCIe 0 port card. Before we close this up, let's put back the 2 front case fans as well. At the front of the case, let's see if my modified drive trays are working. I'm starting on the right, as that allows me to visually see if the connector fits in properly. It's not ideal, but so far it looks like it's working. From the back, although not very visible on the video, all looks fine as well. Time to close up the case. Before we can do that, we first need to install that plastic air duct, followed by the front cover and side panel. I connected everything and now we can power up the machine. Most servers, as far as my experience goes, take a very long time to go through the BIOS part before they start booting up the OS. This machine is no different from that. It takes about a minute even before something is shown on the screen, then definitely more than another one before the system starts to boot the operating system. We do see here that the ML330 detected our 16GB of memory and finds the upgraded X5650 CPU. While waiting for the rest to boot up, I suggest you take some time to enjoy the sound that this thing is making during boot time. After some more waiting, we see a message of the SoSet RAID controller. I'll hit F8 to enter the setup activity. In here, we can create a logical drive and, as hoped, the controller detected all four disks properly. I will continue here to create an array, but this is mainly to remove the warning on boot that there is nothing defined. More on this later. I continued and entered the BIOS utility. Unfortunately, it doesn't really tell us much more about the system. So let's boot into Linux instead. Now that the system booted, a bit more about the RAID controller. The B1110i is not a real RAID controller, unfortunately. It's a so-called fake RAID controller that uses the system CPU instead of offloading to dedicated hardware. More proof of that can be seen as soon as we are in Linux. Despite creating that RAID 0 array in the utility, the disks show up as individual drives since we do not have a kernel module loaded that would hide that. In this case, it's a lot better to use software RAID as it removes the hardware dependencies on the controller, especially when things go wrong. As a final part, let me do some small benchmarks. First, for the storage, I'll create a RAID 0 array using mdadm for those four disks. Then we can test the performance. Nothing too bad here, read and write performance is okay, but this is expected as we're using four disks. Now in terms of CPU performance, I did a test with Geekbench before the upgrade and repeated the same after the upgrade. We can clearly see an improvement here. Not sure what to conclude at this point. The machine is over 10 years old now, and despite it being able to deliver reasonable performance, it's pretty big and loud in comparison with modern hardware for that. Thanks a lot for watching this video. I really hope you enjoyed it, and if you did, please put a thumbs up. If you enjoyed this kind of videos, don't hesitate to subscribe to my channel for more. Thanks again, and I hope to see you back here soon.